Good morning. Welcome to Resurrection Life Online. Today we're having a special service. And you know what? Last Thursday was Auntie Pam's 76th birthday. Should I say the number? You know, we'll wish Auntie Pam the happy birthday, and we'll be back at physical service next Sunday. Pastor Sim will be back, Auntie Pam will be back, and Joshua will be back. And we can't wait to see you then. But today, let's get into the presence of God with your family, with your friends, those of you who are watching overseas. Let's just put our burdens down, you know, leave this set apart this time. Let's seek God, enjoy the service, and we'll come back to see you next Sunday. Bless you.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside.
Yeah. Take this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. You can have it all, Lord. Every part of this life and breathe on this heart that is now yours. All the joy I found surrendering my crown at the feet.
I can lift my voice and say,
can have it all. Every part of my world. Would you take this life and breathe on this heart that is now.
It's time for communion, and I hope that you've already set up your elements ready. You know, today I just want to bring us back to remember, you know, the essence of us being Christians and the essence of why we're taking the communion today. You know, we have the bread that represents the broken body of Christ and the little juice that represents the blood that Jesus shed for you and I. But what does that really mean? I wanted us to remind ourselves today that Jesus is Lord. You know that Jesus is Lord. And you know, in the Bible, it tells us that He created everything. Everything was made by Him. Everything was made for Him. He is the very beginning and He is the very end. In Colossians chapter 1:15, Christ is the image, the visible image of the invisible God, that He existed before anything was created. And God created everything for you. You know, He is Lord. You go, oh, Lord Jesus. But the truth is, He is a loving Lord. He created everything with more colors than you can ever ask for, more beautiful things that decorated it to bless you, to let you know that He is Lord, but He's a loving God. He wants you to know that He loves you. He provided a platform, done everything. He Himself even went to the cross so that you have access to Him in eternity. But today, He gives you and I a choice. And that choice is He Lord? Romans 10:9, our famous verse that says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. And throughout the scriptures, we know it's not just about Jesus is Lord. No, it's really about God knowing your heart more than just things that you say that may be empty. So today the question is Jesus your Lord? Is Jesus your Lord? Sometimes we think about other things that we think about or the things that we tell other people about. Is Jesus Lord over those too? Give you an example. You know, sometimes there are people that I've heard even throughout the last week was tell me, oh, I can never do this. I can never be good enough. There are people that would tell me that, oh, your marriage is, you know, this and that, marriage is too hard, they are too different, let them get a divorce. You know, there are people that would turn around and believe that, you know, oh, I need to wear little to look pretty. And there's so many, you know, fundamental beliefs that we have. And my question to you is, are the things that you say to others or the things that you say to yourself, is Jesus Lord? And if Jesus is Lord in your life, let Him lovingly guide you so that you and I can, you know, just honor Him with our life, just with our thoughts, you know, with what we say, with the things that we do, and the things that we say and declare to other people. So today, when we take communion today, let's remind ourselves, let's allow Jesus be Lord over every single area of our life. Let's take the elements in act in gratitude.
So who loves durians, right? You know, the fact that I just mentioned the word durian, some of us are thinking, nope, no thanks, all yours. You know, personally, I love durians, and I had the chance to have quite a few of it when I went back to Malaysia a few weeks back with my dad, right? You know, Pastor Sim was ministering. We visited some friends and family. And durians are so popular now. And we just so happened to go back at the durian season, at the tail end of the durian season. So what happened was, you know, a trip to Malaysia is not complete without a trip to visit one of those outdoor durian stores, right? They have shelves of durians, and you get to pick the ones from the average priced ones right through the very expensive Musang Kings, and there's a new one now called Blackthorn. Blackthorn. It was delicious, all right? It was so good. And Blackthorn is this new species, and they said it's from a place called Penang. Penang is on the north of Malaysia. It's a beautiful place. And before the trip, we actually planned to go to Penang. So I booked an apartment for my dad and, you know, a few good friends, and to visit Penang, to have a bit of a rest and fellowship. And so I got this nice three-bedroom apartment right in the heart of town, beautiful infinity pools. I got it off Airbnb, and it was really nice. And we drove in, we had full access to the car park, we had full access to the gym, the pool, you know, the whole building essentially. And it was really good. To everybody else outside, it looked like we owned this place. To everybody else outside looking at us, it felt like, oh, wow, you know, how did these guys get this apartment? This apartment, right? But deep down, I knew that even though I had full access to everything, I had the keys, I had, you know, all the passes to the swimming pool and whatnot, that after 3 days, I had to give it back. And I knew that I had to look after this place. It was not mine. It was only mine for 3 days to use. I couldn't put my own photos on the walls. I couldn't party all night. We couldn't, you know, bring durians into the apartment. But it was nice while we had it. You know, this brought me to think about this principle of stewardship. And this is something that I want to share with you today. This powerful principle of stewardship. So a few weeks ago, I was invited to have a chat with a few young working adults from another church, right? They've asked me to come and share or be part of a panel to kind of share tips and ideas on investing, on running a business, or, you know, with a family, you know, to talk about some experiences on, you know, how I run the business or how I do my investments and whatnot. And so I thought, God, man, this is such a big topic. And the room that I'll be speaking to has such a diverse range of people, you know, from people starting work, graduates, new graduates, right through to professionals, you know, medical specialists. So I thought, God, you know, you gotta show me what to share. You gotta teach me. I'm not an expert in investment. I'm not an expert in running a business. You know, even though I've been running a business for over 20 years, I feel like I'm still learning. I have still so much to learn. And, you know, something God put in my heart to share was, you know, just share on this principle of stewardship. You know, how to change your perspective from ownership to stewardship. And I know that every one of us here, every one of us watching right now, that God has given you a very specific set of skills and gifts and talents. And even though some of us may not have the financial resources to, say, start a business or do something, you know, some of us may say, oh, Dan, but it takes money to make money. You know what? I'm not just talking about finances here. There are so many more aspects of life that God has put in you, put in your hands, put in your heart. You know, the purposes that He's put in your heart. It goes beyond just financial prosperity or blessing, right? So for everyone watching, you know, God has given you a specific set of gifts. You know, I want to title this message, if you're taking notes, you know, God can fulfill the desires of your heart with what is in your hands, with what is in your hands. You know, I know that in the room that I'll be speaking to, you know, to the young working adults, that every one of them, wherever they are in life, God has put in them, God has put in you a gift. And it's for us to discover this gift and for us to offer it to Him, you know, to be wise stewards with what He's given to us. You know the statement, what is that in your hands? It's actually a question. It was actually a question that God posed to Moses. You know, Moses was at this moment 80 years old. He'd been hiding in the desert for about 40 years. The last 40 years he'd been hiding from Pharaoh. You know, the first 40 years of his life, he was trained as a prince. He was educated as a prince. He had the best upbringing. But in one day he made a mistake. He killed a fellow Egyptian who was beating his Jewish, you know, countrymen. And he escaped. He ran away. And so for the next 40 years, he was in the desert. He was tending sheep for his father-in-law. He was hiding. He probably was waiting to die, he said, you know, to live the rest of his days out when God called him. You know, God appeared to him in the famous moment with the burning bush, and God asked him. God gave him this purpose, you know, asked him, Moses, you know, can you lead my people out of Egypt? Can you lead my people out of Egypt? You know, Moses at this point was probably not the most confident guy. He probably wasn't expecting God to show up like this and for him to get this mandate, this call, you know, this purpose to lead, you know, the Jewish people out of Egypt. And he had so many doubts. You know, God kept telling him, you know, I will go with you. I will do this for you. But he kept questioning, you know, like so many of us, we have so many questions. We have so many questions, God, but how? You know, Moses thought, but I can't speak. I stuttered, right? And like most of us, we have so many questions when God has asked us to do, you know, something for him, and we were like, no, we can't. I can't. I'm too old, or I'm too young, right? But God asked this question, and it's such a powerful question. God asked him, what is that in your hands? What is that in your hand? You know, and Moses looked down. He was holding a shepherd's rod. He was holding a shepherd's rod, right? And God said, you know what? I can use that. I can use that. And God used that rod, you know, what he had in his hand. You know, he made it available to God. And God used it to do so many miracles. God used it, you know, to show and to remind Moses that if he offered what was in his hand to God, you know, God is faithful to keep his promise. You know, God has put in our hands so many things, you know, so many responsibilities. You know, it's not just finances, but it could be our jobs, our families, our relationships, our assets, our, you know, our gifts, our talents, our work, right? God has put all this into our hands, and it's up to us to steward it. To steward it in a way that will give him glory at the end of the day. You know, we're told not to hoard. We're told not to hoard. You know, the thing is, so many of us, we feel that all these gifts, all these talents, all this time, you know, all our relationships are all ours. We have this perspective that we own everything. You know, just like I mentioned before, you know, that the Airbnb, that apartment that I rented for 3 days, it may seem like I owned it. You know, I had full access to it. You know, I was walking in and walking out, and to anyone else, it looked like, wow, you know, this place belongs to him. But I knew that it was not mine, that I was responsible for it. I had to look after it. I had to manage it well. I had to make sure that you know, it was kept clean, that I didn't do, you know, it wasn't too loud, right? So the question is, what have you got in your hands? What has God put in your hands? You know, what has God put under your responsibility? You know, if we change this perspective of ownership to stewardship, a lot of things will fall into place. And if we understand that, if we are able to offer to God and to steward things under his guidance, you know what? God's going to bless you. God's going to bless what you do with your hands. God's going to bless those around you more than you can imagine. You know, we are in a spiritual world. We're not just in a natural world. We're in a supernatural world. There are so many things that human cannot explain, right? So I want you to believe, and I want you to have faith now and really ask God, God, you know, what have you put in my hands? Help me to see, help me to develop, and help me to be good steward, wise stewards, a wise steward of what you have entrusted me. You know, it could be my family, it could be my kids, it could be my business, it could be my work, my employment, my employees. Lord, I want to give all this to you. You know, I want to tell you this story now of a man called Hans Wilstorf. Hans Wilstorf. You know, Hans was born in Germany, right? When he was 12, you know, it was pretty sad that both his parents passed away months from each other. So as an orphan, he was put under the care of his uncle, who sent, you know, Hans and his two other siblings. He was the middle child, right? So the uncle sent, you know, the three siblings off to boarding school. You know, they had a good education. You know, the uncle wanted them to have a good education at the very least. You know, Hans wasn't the best at school in terms of, you know, he didn't have the best experience at school, but he did have an affinity to maths and to science and to engineering. And so he focused on his schoolwork. You know, he focused on those things. And at 19, he moved to Switzerland. So when he was in Switzerland, he started working for a watchmaking company. You know, back then, the most common watches were the ones where you wore in your pockets. You know, it wasn't like wristwatches or the top. So he started working for this company. And after that, when he was 24, he moved to London to start a watch company with his business partner. And you know what? After a while, he named this company Rolex. You know, many of us would have heard this term or would have heard this brand name Rolex, right? It's a billion-dollar brand. They make luxury watches. They're known to make watches of high quality. And you know, at the moment, you know, there are some of the watches that you can't even get it. They're so popular that you have to be on a waiting list for about 2 to 3 years. And if you're lucky, you know, they will give you a call and say, hey, you know what? We have a watch for you. You know, they're so popular. They make billions of dollars every year. But what many people don't know is that Rolex is actually a non-profit. They don't have shareholders. They are fully 100% a non-profit organization. Because in 1944, you know, Hans Wilstorf, his wife passed away. And, you know, the next year, what he did was he shifted all his shares of Rolex into a non-profit, a charitable fund. You know, of all the billions of dollars that they make, a bulk of it, if not most of it, goes into grants, goes into helping education, goes into, you know, grants for exploration, for the community, for education, for the arts, for sports. It was his heart. It was his heart to create something so great. He was entrusted with this gift, with this business, you know, that he built. And he said, you know what? I want this business to be a legacy, to outlast me. He wanted it to be one that perpetually kept giving back. And I love this story, you know. It's one of those brands that I see, you know, I work in marketing and I see that, wow, not many brands get to be at this level. You know, Hans had this vision. He put everything into this nonprofit. And you know, in the year 2021, 2020 and 2021, the foundation gave out almost 4,500 grants around the world. Isn't that an inspiring story? You know, I love this story. I love the fact that, you know, we can use what we have in our hands or our giftings and to do it so well that it is so valuable to the marketplace, but also in a way that we can glorify God with it. You know, he was born into a Christian family. And I'm sure that, you know, his parents would have instilled in him the values of being faithful with what we have. You know, blessed to be a blessing, right? Blessed to be a blessing. You know, I want to inspire you. I want to encourage us all today that whatever we have, you know, in our hands, that God, if we use it for his glory, if we put it for his purpose, he will multiply it. He will bless it. He will do something so supernatural with it. And you know, a lot of times we cannot explain it, right? You know, in Matthew 23, verse 11, you know, Jesus said, you know, the greatest among you should be a servant. You know, Hans believed that, you know, he can serve many by doing what he does best and by being generous and giving back and having that long-term vision for his business. You know, some of you may say, Daniel, I'm struggling as it is. You know, the interest rates are going up. I'm just trying to stay above the water level at this point. You know, I don't have, you know, the capacity. I don't have the resources to be generous or to how do I steward? You know, what are some areas that I can steward? Or I'm too young. You know, I don't have a job. You know, but I want to tell you right now, everyone has something. You know, what is that in your hand? You know, if God was to ask you, what is that in your hands? What have I given to you? You know, some of us, it could be stewarding our time. You know, something basic. You know, a lot of us, we all have 24 hours a day, right? Stewarding our time well. What are we focusing on? What are we prioritizing? You know, a lot of time is one of those things that you can't get back. You can't get back, right? Are we stewarding our time wisely, or are we just, you know, letting it go past as if we own our life? And I want to tell you that as much as you think you own your life, you don't. And if you're a believer like me, if you believe that Christ has redeemed us, he has bought us with a price, I believe we owe him our life. We owe him our time, you know, our time for ourselves, our time to serve others, you know, our time. You know, another area is the area of health. A lot of things that we steward, like I said, it's not just money, right? Our health, we have this responsibility. You know, you can have all the money in the world, you can have all the fame in the world. If you don't have health, it's gonna be tough. It's gonna be tough. So while you have health, I pray that you value it, you treasure it, because a lot of times we don't really appreciate good health until we don't have it, right? You know, stewarding our health, stewarding it in a way that give him glory, right? One area is our kids. You know, some of us may have kids, young kids or old kids, and you know, this principle of stewardship makes it, I want to say, you know, it takes the pressure off us that our kids are not ours. Our kids are God's. You know, we entrust them to God. You know, we guide them. We lead them, you know, with the power and the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. We guide our kids in his ways. You know, for me, I've got four kids. And I tell you that it really is by the grace of God. Right, you know, we really need the grace and we really need the wisdom of God to really guide them and to bring them up in a way that pleases God, you know, that for them to honor and care for others, for them to love their parents, for them to love and trust God. You know, that is my heart. That is my heart for my kids. And I know that at the end of the day, they are not mine, they are not, you know, my wife Jen's, but they are God's. And we are here as you know, temporary guardians, and we have to steward that responsibility well. You know, another area of stewardship is in the area of learning. You know, to be humble enough to want to learn more. You know, I feel that we are always on a continual journey to learn and to improve, right? You know, God has given us this ability to think, ability to change, right? You know, a tree, the best that a tree can grow is just go up. It doesn't have a choice. You know, it will grow up as high as it can, right? But for us as humans, you know, God has given us this beautiful gift of free will. We get to choose. We get to choose if we want to continue down this path of you know, of laziness or you know, of complacency, or we get to choose that we can continually learn and improve, not just for us, not just for ourselves, but for others around us, you know, to be a blessing. We've been given this wonderful gift, right, of free choice. And I just pray that we will understand and that we will continually walk humbly to learn. You know, learning is one of those things. You know, I'll be sharing with the young adults group that if they wanted to learn on investing, trading, running a business, you know, there's books written about all this. It's just a matter of taking the time to learn. Okay? Taking the time to learn. You know, just as we walk, you know, in Christ, just as we walk as believers, it's just taking the time to study the Word, taking the time to seek God, to seek the Holy Spirit, to speak, to pray, to rest, to learn how to rest in Him. You know, all this comes down to being humble and to being humble enough to learn. No matter what age you are, you can always learn. You know, this is a stewardship that we have. You know, this mind that God has given to us, it is such a wonderful gift. And I pray that we don't take it for granted. We don't take it like, okay, we know everything, we own everything. But this is our responsibility to keep learning. You know, when it comes to the area of finance or investing and savings, I want to read you this verse from the Bible, from Proverbs 13, verse 11. It says, "Wealth from get-rich-quick schemes quickly disappears. Wealth from hard work grows over time." You know, wealth from get-rich-quick schemes quickly disappears, but wealth from hard work grows over time. You know, there's such power in this verse. There's such power in really appreciating what God has put under your responsibility, or appreciating what God has put, you know, in your hands. You know, as an employer, you know, and I speak for employers, I'm sure, everywhere else, that the most valuable team members are the ones who are able to use whatever resources they have at hand to go beyond. You know, a lot of times, and I know a lot of employees feel that, oh, I don't have enough resources to do this. I don't have the support of this team, or I don't have, you know, like the resources of some big company to do this. But you know what? Trust God. Trust God with what you have. Allow Him to work through you. Ask Him for wisdom. You know, the times of weakness are the best times to ask God. You know, church, I really want to wrap up this short encouragement today by reading you this verse from Revelations. Revelations 4, verse 11. You know, it says, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." You know, it says to me that God owns all things. He created all things. This is such a great reminder that you know, if we shift our perspective from ownership to stewardship, so many things will fall into place. When we can really understand the principle of stewardship, you know, tithing becomes easier. It makes sense that we are just stewarding the finances that He has put in us, through us, for His kingdom. We are just stewarding it. We're just looking after it. We are managers. We are responsible for this. You know, when we can understand, you know, the idea of stewardship rather than ownership, it takes so much pressure off us. when it comes to raising our kids, when it comes to, you know, guiding our kids or our children, that they belong to God. They don't belong to us. That we are just responsible, that we have to trust God, that God is the one who supplies all our needs. He's the one who gives us the power to create wealth, you know, in Deuteronomy. We trust God. You know, when we understand the principle of stewardship, you know, looking after yourself, you know, your health, your time, being responsible for what God has put in our hands, it becomes almost like a mandate, a purpose for us to glorify Him with what we have. When we understand that our time is not our own, that our life, you know, on earth, as short as it is not our own, it helps us to focus. It helps us to clarify our vision moving forwards. You know, I pray and I pray that, you know, for all of us, that we can understand this. You know, as we continually walk, as we continually journey with God, you know, every step, you know, not every day is going to be easy, but as long as we know that God is in control, that we can take the next step. If we appreciate what He has put in our hands, sometimes it's good, sometimes it may not seem as good, but as long as we trust God that He can use it for His purpose and for His glory, you know, this is a powerful thing. If we can shift our perspective from ownership to stewardship, man, God can do so much through us. You know, one thing is clear when, and I can see this in people who understand this power or this principle of stewardship, that I see that they value the time that they invest in church, in the people in church, in the church family, that they know that what they do is not just for this lifetime, but it goes beyond. You know, when you understand the power of stewardship and the principle of stewardship, you realize that we have this responsibility to be the hands and feet of God. Right? You know, I want to pray today. I want to pray for you, and I want to pray for us as a church, that we really understand this, and that God will open our eyes, open the eyes of our heart, to really see and understand this principle of stewardship, that everything belongs to Him. Amen. Lord, I want to thank You. I want to trust You. Lord, we offer what You have put in our hands to You. That You guide us, that You lead us, Holy Spirit, that You will continually empower us with Your wisdom, with Your grace, with Your strength, with Your peace, that every step that we take, that we will take it with You, that we will trust You with what is in our hands, what that You have put under our responsibilities, that we will look at things with the perspective of stewardship, that we don't own it, but that we are here to be responsible on Your behalf. Lord, we want to thank You for this. We want to trust You. We want to thank You for this church and this family. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you.
While He is crucified.
his life was taken, so I was granted mine. My wealth is in the cross. There's nothing more I want than just to know his love. My heart is set on Christ, and I will count all else as loss. The greatest of my crowns mean nothing to me now, for I counted up the cost, and all my wealth is in the cross. I will not boast in riches. I have no pride in gold, but I will boast in chains. Let this be my confession.